No, I'm talking about the harsh realities of the assemblies and how the Bruijn graphs face these realities. During the course of the discussion, we have made some ridiculous, unrealistic assumptions. Like, we assume that we have perfect coverage of the genome by reads. That means at each position on the genome, we have a read generated at that position. Secondly, we assume that reads are error-free. Thirdly, we assume that multiplicity of camels are known. And also, we assume the distance between reads within read pairs were known exactly. But in reality, these assumptions do not hold. We don't have perfect coverage of genome by reads. Reads are error-prone. The multiplicity of camels are not known either. The distance between reads within read pairs are inexact. And there are many other problems. But let's go to the first unrealistic assumption, perfect coverage. Here we have the genome on the top, and here are the four reads. Clearly that we don't have the perfect coverage in this case, and violates the K assumption of the de Bruijn graph. So, what you can do is to break the reads into shorter camels. And after this operation, the key assumption of the de Bruijn graph holds. What is next? About the erroneous reads. This is an erroneous read. By breaking erroneous read into a series of camels, we also generate false camels. And how this false camel appears in the graph? Well, if camels were exact, then for any region of the genome, the Bruijn graph would look like this. But when we introduce incorrect camel into the graph, we create purple. Imagine, for an assembly dataset, usually we have millions of incorrect camels. And they form a lot of bubbles. So the challenge here is to find out how the genome traverses this graph, depicting by the color lines. Researchers have developed algorithms for removing these bubbles and simplify the graph. But should the graph look very simple after this step? Well, this is the graph of bacteria genome after simplification. And now it is time to ask and answer the question, who are these people? Pavel, are you still here?
Yes.
Okay, can you answer the question?
So these people are not criminals. These are scientists and entrepreneurs who made their genomes available a few years ago and started the personalized genomics revolution. And today, these personalized genome sequencing efforts are in full bloom, and we will soon expand sequencing to millions of individuals. At the same time, there are efforts to sequence thousands of genomes, and we will soon have nearly all mammalian genomes, for example, sequenced. Simultaneously with this, there are enormous effort to sequence cancer genomes and understand what changes in the genome lead to cancer. And at the heart of these genomics revolutions are bioinformaticians like Sean, who has been working for two decades now to develop new algorithmic ideas for genome sequencing. You may ask, why in the world we started by making some ridiculous assumptions that Sean had to address in the last segment of this presentation. So there was a good reason for this. Without this assumption, we wouldn't be able to present the main ideas of existing genome sequencing algorithms. And it's actually a common thing in bioinformatics to simplify the problem to the point that it becomes ridiculous. Solve this problem, which means to develop the key idea for solving ridiculous problem, and then overcome some ridiculous assumptions, something that Sean described in the last segment.